Russian wind, probably from the state of Kentucky, which is my brother going, his oldest daughter has graduated from high school. And on Mother's Day, I think that's perfectly appropriate to remember my brother, my younger brother, Keith, and his eldest daughter, Rachel. And he finally did it. So this goes out to Keith on Father's Day. Parables are such slippery things to get a hold of. And there are times when people will tell you a story. There are lots of people out there who are greatly skilled at telling stories. And there are some of us who are not so good at telling stories or telling jokes. Sometimes it really is easy to see how a story can be held differently from one moment to the next. If a really good storyteller tells the same story or the same joke from one moment and then to a different audience and tells it the same way, in the same pattern, the same words even, it's not the same. Sometimes, you know, the joke that left your lunch crew absolutely in stitches, when you tell it to your family, they look at you like you have two heads. Parables are quite often like that. Now, everybody's experienced this phenomenon. And you've all probably heard things like, I guess you had to be there. It's kind of like a location joke. Or it loses something in translation from Tennessee to Maryland. Quite often things lose something in translation. And you can always maybe look back on the lyrics of rock songs. What the blazes are they saying? I can remember a number of times trying desperately to catch the lyrics to that Bob Dylan tune. And rap just totally lost on me. I can't hear it. It officially marks me as an old geezer. Fact is, storytelling of any sort is sometimes an unrepeatable art. A good storyteller will be the first to tell you that there are many variables in storytelling, including the mood of the people listening, the inflection of the voice, the mood of the day, the weather, who knows? It's that intangible thing which makes it alive. It's one of the things, to be honest with you, that makes my co-pastor so very good at preaching, because quite often she can read the mood of the congregation and it just changes it just ever so slightly. And it really connects. Some of us were working on that. Jesus is a great storyteller. And the gospel writers tell us that Jesus chose to speak in parables, a fact that will annoy many, many people, as it surely annoyed a number of people in his day. Why didn't Jesus just come out and say what he meant? Why did he leave behind, or why did he leave behind these cryptic little sayings loaded with innuendo instead of a crisp code of laws or a stack of essays with titles like How to Be a Good Disciple? A brief definition of what the kingdom of God really is. Seven keys of the coming kingdom and what it means to you. But no, instead we get this cryptic, awkward collection of sayings known as the parables of Jesus. He could have spoken in bullet format, given us a list of rules for life, but list of rules never change. They never adapt. Written laws are like insects encased in lucite in some laboratory somewhere. They're beautiful and precise, but they're no longer alive. They no longer breathe. If you think Jesus would have gotten his points across better with hard, fast rules, then remember the last time you sat down and really enjoyed that reading of Leviticus. never like to be told the same way twice. And it keeps breathing new life into the very Word of God. Jesus' parables have the ability to engage us, to entice us into their world, and to relate the central truth of that story to us and to our own lives. Through Jesus' parables, He made us followers of the good news, and He made us own them as our own story. They enter into our own experience. As you and I are swept up in a story, we become part of a new story. And that story is written in our very own lives. And we are all part of that story. This church, the church universal, if you will, we are all put together, and all of our experiences become a part of the kingdom of God. If you think that our tradition stems only from the four Gospels, those four stories of Matthew, Luke, John, and Mark, you're only half right. There is also almost 2,000 years of stories, of Gospels, of parables, if you will, that go along with it. There's, if you will, the Gospel of Augustine, or the Gospel of Martin Luther, or the Gospel of Thomas Merton. How about the Gospel of Ray Kinsley? All these Gospels have remained vital parts of our tradition because the old story, that old story has been re-energized, revitalized through the lives, the story of the lives of these people. Other Gospels may not be quite so well known, but they have worked just as pervasively in our lives. And I think it's appropriate that on Father's Day we should stop and consider how drastically some of these Gospels have affected our lives. I can think of for a moment about the Gospel according to Dad, the Gospel according to Grandpa, or the Gospel according to Aunt Mary. How about the Gospel according to that kid again, whose name I can never remember? The Gospel according to the man who's sitting across from me at the support group meeting. See, we are not only affected by the fight stories of the Bible or the faith stories of historical figures. We're influenced by the faith stories of those we know personally, those who have written their stories on our hearts, and we have taken their stories. All of us are in the process of writing our own gospel, our own account of experiencing the coming kingdom of God into our midst. Writing a gospel through the very act of living is part of being a disciple. And then we get to tell a story about it. Storytelling is one of those basic practices common to all human culture. Stories collect us, connect us to one another, to our ancestors, to our world, and even to God. So, what gospel was written in your heart today? How did the parables act out in your life, witness to your faith? How about the parable of the crabby boss? The parable of the kids who won't clean up their rooms? How about the parable of the pay raise? How about the parable of the emergency surgery without medical insurance? What the parable of the family who cannot communicate with each other? Or the parable of the addict who just found out he or she is going to become a parent? Some of the particular stories you have experienced this week may not seem to have any great significance or grand design. The real power of your experiences may not be obvious until sometime later. It may take a long time for those seeds to germinate. When I was living in Georgia, my first house, I decided I wanted to plant a garden. And so I went to the backyard and I planted a garden. charge, so I argued. And I did a good job too. I mean, it was beautiful, straight rows, mulched with straw, and had those little popsicle sticks, which identified what I had planted. And every day, I would go, when I come home from work, I'd go out back, and I'd check and see what was springing up. And if the little thinnest bit of green was poking through that straw, I would water the hell out of it. I was going to nurture the living crud out of this garden. Water, as it turns out, was not going to be a problem, because there was a humongous thunderstorm, which dumped, I don't know how many feet of water on South Georgia that year. And my little corner garden happened to be in a garden. Rather scrub, clean, nothing left. I looked down in the garden and there was piles of debris and yard litter, straw, leaves, twigs, large limbs from all over the neighborhood. So much for my first effort at kitchen garden. So I spread it all out, made it look kind of sort of neat, pulled out the big ones, spread a little sod in it, made it look like it was meant to be there, like that it was a cultivated area, and I forgot about it. It was a particularly busy time in my life, so for the next month or so, it was gone. I didn't get home for 2-3 weeks. Then I got home, and I noticed that next day, strange stuff. I mean, I had corn stalks coming up through the lawn, through the sod. I had beans growing up right by the driveway. And watermelon growing in the strips. You have to wait. Sometimes you don't know how the seeds you plant are going to germinate. You don't know how that tiny little effort that you make with another person is going to bear fruit. It's kind of like saying something to one of the young people here, getting to know them by name, and letting them know that you know who they are. That may be the only opportunity you have, but that may be enough for them to blossom, to bear really good fruit. Part of this faith is that we pledge to each other our constant love and support. And as we leave here today and we return to our lives, we should realize that we have a story to tell, and it is the story of our lives. It is with those seeds that we plant with truly important fruit. Amen. Our next hymn is number 540.